Our response shall be, "Thank you, Lord. Jesus, we have gathered today to learn your word, your will. For this opportunity, we pray, Thank you, Lord. Jesus, you have blessed us with family and a strong support system by which today we can make it. Thank you, Jesus, for this blessing. Altogether, we pray, Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, you support us through our trials. And even amid this pandemic, you have touched us in numerous ways which we cannot see. For this comfort that you provide us, altogether we pray, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, you gave us the Holy Bible, which is nothing but your word. You gave us this opportunity today to study. You gave us your son Jesus, you in the flesh. For this wisdom, we pray, thank you, Lord. Let's all together sing, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All together, let's say a Hail Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Thank you so much, Renisha Mal, for that spontaneous, creative, heartfelt prayer. God bless you, and we wish you all God's graces for you and for your family. Good. Now let's move to the session. First of all, formal welcome to each and every one of you with all your usual energy and enthusiasm. And to match your energy and to ignite your energy and enthusiasm, we have a very dynamic, well-known scripture scholar, Father Mari Arul Raja. Mari Arul Raja was for several years a dean and a superior of Regional Theologate Center in Chennai. He had guided several people and led them in the process of theology. Besides that, he is also a wonderful powerful speaker who can animate and enlighten people. And currently, he is the director of Interreligious Dialogue and Cultural Center in Loyola College, Chennai. So that's a wonderful center that is growing up. He is the director of that IDCR. And today he is going to talk to us about the most important book in the Bible, Acts of the Apostles, a kind of a foundational story of all of us. So therefore, Father Mari Arul Raja, Dr. Father Mari Arul Raja, most welcome to you. And we are in fact privileged to have you this evening. Over to you to enlighten our brothers and sisters, our learners here. Welcome, Father.
Good. Thank you, Rajkumar, and thank you, the family of the VJ Depth. The very name consoles me. It always goes for the depth, and the deeper than the depth. And you know, we share our faith from the depths of our heart. Rather, we radiate from the depths of our heart the faith energies that we are, along with our families, with all our struggles, with all our difficulties, with all our multiple challenges, visible as well as invisible. And also, especially in terms of the corona waves one after another. Straight away, we move into let me move into the presentation. Let me move into the presentation. Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles. You know, Jesus was murdered in the 30s, perhaps 30, 33 or 36. Do you see my screen?
Not yet. It's coming up.
You know, this book of Acts is placed right after the four canonical gospels and just before the epistles, Pauline epistles. So it is jammed in between the gospel on the one hand and the Pauline epistles on the other hand, out of the 27 books of the book of Acts. Is it visible?
Yes, Father.
Yes.
That's yes, the Father.
One. Yes, Father.
Let me move into the slideshow. You know, Luke is supposed to be the author. The recipients are, in the very beginning itself, we come across in the first book, Theophilus. Theo means God. Philos means lover, the lover of God. This is a proper name. This could be also a generic name. Whoever loves God, whoever is open to God, whoever is attuned to God. So perhaps this Theophilus might be a Christian Gentile high official and also every lover of God. My dear Theophilus, in the first book, which is the Luke, the Gospel of Luke, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles. So perhaps this book was written after 30 years, nearly 30 to 40 years of the murder of Jesus. Remember the gap of 30 years. You know, the purpose is to record the history of the church from Pentecost to Paul's arrival in Rome. This is a second part narrative of the Christian origins. And from this first initial introductory remarks, you know, these days we talk about the question of letter writing habit has gone down because of the emails or because of the other networks like Twitter or email or whatever it be. Very often, only with a small little formulations we communicate ourselves. There is no question of formality. This is a very formal beginning, from, to, and so on. The purpose. So Luke 1, verses 1 to 4, this particular Luke is the introduction to the Acts of the Apostles is very much found in these four verses. Quite often, Luke is called as a beloved physician in the early church. And very much this title is given by Paul, none other than Paul. He seemed to accompany Paul on some missionary journeys. The references are given. The PowerPoint would be sent to you. And here we come across in Colossians, Philemon, and Timothy, 2 Timothy. The writer of Acts might not have lived with or seen Jesus. Apparently, it was not neither the part of the College of the Disciples, not even because Luke was living elsewhere. Jesus was living elsewhere. His identity is not known with certainty, but he is very much involved in the very act of spreading the good news. Rather, let me put it, democratizing the good news, democratizing the heartbeat of God, democratizing the compassion of God. You know, just as by way of certain introductory remarks, the early church, the baby church, you know, baby church was considered as a splinter group moving away from the mainline Jewish world. Jesus was born out of the womb of the Jewish faith, belonging to the covenant, belonging to the Tanakh, Torah, Nevi'im, Ketubim, and Exodus event, and the new covenant, and so on and so forth. The new converts, a minority group, elsewhere, living everywhere, and these new converts were involved in four activities. You know, they were devoted to the apostles' teachings. They were involved in their personal as well as a communitarian prayer, together, praying together, and radiating their faith energies to one another, clockwise, anti-clockwise. And there was a koinonia, this is in Greek, biblical Greek, the fellowship, together as a fellows, as the equals, as the children of God, they shared their communion together. That's what we call by fellowship. The Lord's Supper, remember me. The Lord's Supper, remember me. This is the Lord's Supper. See, this was the key word for them. And with regard to Acts of the Apostles, we got two heroes. The first part, perhaps from 1 to 12. Out of 28 chapters, we have Peter in the first instance and Paul from 13 onwards. Though Paul appears in the on 7th.
Cannot hear.
Father Raja, your microphone is off. It has automatically become off. Can you please turn it on? And also now your slides are moving. Yeah, but microphone is not yet turned on. Unmute. No.
Okay.
Yes.
Is it okay? It's there.
Perfect.
Thank you for alerting me. And you know, Paul seemed to have, Christ seemed to have appeared to Paul four times. At his conversion, falling from the horse on the way to Damascus, and in Corinth. And in Corinth, we come across that in Acts 18, chapter 18. And on his first visit to Jerusalem, Acts 22, and during his last visit to Jerusalem in Acts 23. 1 minute. Is my slide moving?
No,
Father.
No, it is in that Christ appears to Paul four times. There we are.
Yeah.
Okay. You can move with your mouse sometimes. Sometimes there is the issue. With your mouse, you can just roll that button. It goes to the next slide.
1 minute. 1 minute.
Because the slide appears good. Only thing, if you just start moving with mouse, it can go easily.
Actually, Father, I think you're sharing, you're not sharing the presentation screen. You're sharing the file that is open.
Is it moving?
No, Father.
Oh, let me move out and just come back again.
Now it is moving. Now it has come to new converts were involved in four.
Okay. So these are four appearances that we come across. most scholars think that Luke and Acts, these two writings, were written after 70, after 40, nearly 40 years of the murder of Jesus, when this Caesar Titus demolished Jerusalem. This is a major event, my dear friends. The demolition of the temple was a major event. The author has knowledge of the siege of Jerusalem. The author has a knowledge of siege of Jerusalem. And you see the eschatological discourse in the book of Luke and also in 19. And after the Jewish wars, note down the dates. The Jewish wars, the entire people, you know, people came together with arms, with armed struggle. And between 60 and 90, there was always a constant tension. So perhaps in the mid 80s, Paul should have written. Some say in 60s, Paul should have written. Do you remember the first ever document from the New Testament is none other than 1 Thessalonians in 49, just about 15 years after Jesus' death. The second document was the second document was perhaps the Corinthians. And after a few epistles of Paul was perhaps murdered by 63 or 67. 67, Paul should have been murdered or persecuted. And in this Acts of the Apostles, we don't come across the murder of Paul, the persecution of Paul. So with the 28, we have this particular understanding that Paul was very much in the prison in Rome. So Luke is as the author is addressing Theophilus. It's a sort of both in Luke's gospel as well as in the Acts of Apostles. Why we call it always a Luke hyphen Acts? Because of the identical style in writing. By the way, in the entire Gospel of Luke, in the entire Acts of the Apostles, we come across the same style. In the entire New Testament, Luke's Greek is rather polished. You know, whereas the Mark's Gospel is very much at the preliminary stage. You know, Luke and Acts have to be read together. You know, sometimes in the Acts of the Apostles, we come across I. Sometimes in the very expression be we. The writer was an eyewitness to what he was writing. So whenever we come across we, he is representing a team. The team of the early apostles or the early disciples or the early Christians. For example, chapter 16, chapter 20, 27, and 28. So whenever you bump into this particular word, we, remember Luke is representing the entire group. This says, you know, remember, today our mode of communication is in terms of electronic media, in terms of WhatsApp and so on. In those days, writing was very much operative in terms of what you call the colonial governance for political purposes and the communication of the armies and also only to the elite of the society, only to the moneyed people. But remember that particular medium of writing was brought to the common people. That was a fantastic, that was a very, very great movement forward. In other words, pulling down a media power for embracing the ordinary people, for communicating the ordinary people, for building the community of the people. So intended for a wider reading audience than just the Theophilus. That's why I told you Theophilus is not only an individual, but perhaps Paul wanted it to be all the lovers of God. The origin of Christianity's beginning among the Jews is the first part, because the seeds of the word of God is spread as the sort of, you know, epicenter of this radiation of the good news from Jerusalem for Luke. For Luke, Jerusalem is the epicenter of the entire Jesus event. Jesus event. He was killed and buried in Jerusalem, and he was elevated to the high heavens from Jerusalem. And this from Jerusalem, it is spreading into the entire world. Remember, what was the epicenter of the entire colonial world of the Caesars? Rome. For Luke, the epicenter of the, rather, the bombardment of God, what you call the eruption of the Lord, is from Jerusalem. See, in the beginning, the origin of Christianity is beginning from among the Jews. Much of the book is concerned with the transfer of the center of interest from Jerusalem to Antioch. Slowly, as the gospel is spreading, it is going by and by. So frequently you come across the word of God spread, and the faithful were increasing in numerous number. They become large numbers. It was spreading out. They're spreading the gospel to the non-Gentile world, from the divine to the humans, from the humans, the Jews to the Gentiles. So he wants to have a historical account. Don't mix up our understanding of history today and their understanding of early days, Luke's understanding of history. This is not a historical textbook anyway. But this is a faith document in terms of being the witness and growing as a witness. And for which he is collecting information from the early church and coming out with the orderly account. So he makes use of the history of his understanding, the history of his understanding in the first century. So on that count, it's a historical account to meet the need of both the Jew and the Gentile. You know, this is a very crucial issue. I have got a treasure, and can I have the treasure to be given to all the people of goodwill, irrespective of the creed, caste, culture, color, and so on and so forth. So this is a historical account of how the gospel was spread from the Jewish world to the Gentile world. The book of Acts is idealized accounts of the beginnings of the church. I raise a question at this particular juncture. Early Christian church, at the infant level, at the infancy level, it was idealized. Was Luke moving from the real church to an ideal church? Or he had a picture of an ideal church and just was portraying the real church? You know, in the Acts of the Apostles, we have got the usual infights, personality clashes, and also communitarian tensions. And also, even in terms of purity and pollution, as we come across in the Indian context, the caste system as well. Was there any gender equality over there in the early church? Was there an oppression of the women? Was there a patriarchy? Was there a racism? Was there a caste in the church? You can smell each of them. Of course, in the first century Palestinian idioms, first century Greek idioms, and so on. The book of Acts seems to be an idealized account of beginnings of the church. The author focuses on two leaders only, mainly Peter and Paul. Peter dominates the first half of the book, 1 to 12, and represents the Jewish Christian centered in Jerusalem. Peter was rather having a privileged place while he was with Jesus. And slowly, entire Paul, the personality of Paul, the Pauline, even you can see the domination of the Pauline discourses in the New Testament. You count Acts of the Apostles from 13 to 28, and all the sectors, all the epistles written by Paul, Ro, Ko, Gal, Ephi, Kol, Te, Tim, Ti, Philem, Heb, Romans, Ko, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Ro, Ko, Gal, Ephi, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Gal, Ephi, Kol, Te, Colossians, Timothy 1 and Timothy 2, Tim, Ti, Colossians, Thessalonians, Thessalonians. Colossians, Thessalonians, Thessalonians. Tim, First Timothy, Second Timothy, and Titus. Philemon. Then the last one would be Hebrews. There is a sort of discussion whether it was originally from Paul or not. So the entire, if at all you count the Pauline world, focusing on the Pauline activities in the early church, Paul seems to be dominating next to Christ. Whereas Peter, the illiterate man, Paul is the doctor of the church. In the sense, he was having the highest degree possible in those days, and he was trained under Gamaliel. Luke depicts the church as a model of harmony and cooperation. Today we talk about interreligious harmony, international harmony. There is a culture of dialogue that is being promoted. It's a model of harmony and cooperation. This is in contrast to the picture that one gets from Pauline letters. In Pauline letters, we come across personality clashes, conflict between person. And, you know, Pauline letters were response to the conflicts in the community and response to the heresies in the communities. It was a response for, you know, building. I'm fed up with you, Paul says in some places. I have to admonish you. I have to just take you to task. And this is not the way. For example, 1 Corinthians is full of conflict resolution. It could be in terms of eating the meat bought from the market, or is it in terms of, you know, the question of immoral life, a fellow living with his own father's wife somewhere, and also even in terms of sexual abuse, and also even in terms of certain confusions regarding the question of resurrection, the question of the Eucharistic celebration. Eucharistic celebration, is it meant for building the community or fragmenting the community? You celebrate Eucharist, but you are maintaining your own community. So this was the real picture. Whereas while going through the pages of the Acts of the Apostles, page after page, chapter after chapter, we come across the beautiful evolution of a triumphalist history in such a way. So this is in contrast to the picture that one gets from Paul's letter. Paul in Acts is a team player. Paul in Acts is a, right from the beginning, my dear friends, I was so surprised to see Jesus was never an individualist. The moment he got enlightened, the moment he was bombarded by the divine, the moment he was very much taken up by the Holy Spirit in the River Jordan, the next activity was team building. Team building. Ecclesia means to be called together. You know, together I am born, together I am to be sustained, and together I am to end up with my fulfillment. So it's in the community, it is something like a communitarian salvation. Our destiny is not a personalistic salvation, not an individualistic salvation. Christian message comes out with a communitarian dimension always. So Paul in the Acts of the Apostles is a team player. Luke uses the same themes in Acts that he uses in his account of the good news, so-called good news. The Spirit-directed faith. The Spirit-directed faith. The faith-triggered activities. And the hope-triggered interventions. And the charity-triggered works. So it is ultimately a faith-directed, Spirit-directed faith. And innocent of insurrection against Roman authority, he here doesn't unnecessarily bring in the conflicts. Here also in the Acts of the Apostles, we come across the conflicts, but quite often inner conflicts. For example, in Acts chapter 15, the first conflict is arising in terms of Jews versus Gentiles. And the divinely predestined to spread the ends of the earth. You know, a fire has to make everything else a fire. The fire is spreading always. So it is not a sort of a treasure put down under the bushel. Put down under the bushel. In the Acts 2, verses 2 to 4, the descent of the Holy Spirit at the Pentecost. My dear friends, Pentecost is none other than 50 days. Penta means something to do with five. it is a harvest festival, and that on that occasion, it is something like a pongal in Tamil Nadu. It's a something to Makar Sankranti, and it is a sort of harvest festival. In other words, this festival of Pentecost and the harvest, this evokes a sort of, you know, harvesting of the spirit, harvesting of the fruits of the spirit. So spirit from above descending down. Remember, with regard to the reception of the Holy Spirit, there are multiple expressions regarding the reception of the Holy Spirit in the Acts of the Apostles. You know, with regard to chapter 2, in the scene of the Pentecostal event as such, it was an upper room where all the disciples, all the apostles and all the faithful, and Mother Mary is also there. It was in the upper room. There were sounds of wind. You see the audio effect. Look into the tongues of fire, tongue-shaped fire. And they're talking in tongues, multiple languages, and laying on of the hands. Spirit received after salvation. Spirit received at the moment of salvation. You know, in chapter 2 in the Pentecostal, these elements are here. Sounds, tongues, speaking in tongues, and the laying in of hands is not here, but in other places. In many places, laying of hands for the descending of the Spirit, for performing the wonderful deeds for healing and so on. In chapter 8, we have only these two, lay on of the hands, Spirit received after salvation. In chapter 10, speak in tongues and the Spirit received at the moment of salvation. Chapter 19, speaks in tongues and lay of hands, and the Spirit received at the moment of salvation. Let's have certain more details. The Holy Spirit's work. What are the works of the Holy Spirit? Holy Spirit's mission. We can have his mission or her mission was first promised by Christ. It's a gift of God. Very much pre-told by Christ. We have this particular aspect of 1:8. The Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You see the movement. The Holy Spirit, as soon as the descending of the Holy Spirit occurs, the movement goes from Judea, Jerusalem, to Samaria, Bethel, and so on. Gentile, one leap forward, and to the ends of the world and all the Gentiles across. So Holy Spirit is something to do with the articulation by the life and mission of Christ. This promise is fulfilled on the day of Pentecost. You carefully look into all these verses, Acts 2, 1 to 4, 15 to 21, and 2 to 23. Promise fulfilled on the day of Pentecost. Thirdly, the work of the Holy Spirit is to reveal the gospel, opening up the heart, and, you know, very much planting the gospel, revealing the gospel. Calypsis means hiding. Apocalypsis is opening up. It is not quantum by quantum of opening, but the entirety of the opening. The revelation of the gospel. It is given in other references also. It is confirmed by the word. The word is confirmed by the miracles. It is always there. In the Acts of the Apostles, we come across many, many miracles. Not for the elevation of the miracle worker to the high pedestal. Quite often, church fathers use the stories of miracles. What for? For proving the divinity of Christ. But according to Christ, what happens? The miracles are not meant for giving the headline report for the grandeur of the miracle worker. It is meant for locating the hand of God. For Jesus, For Jesus, the kingdom of God is nothing but the heartbeat of God. If God is living, why the fellow should die? If God is living, why the woman has to be crushed? If God is living, why there should be a gang rape? If God is living, that was the understanding of the kingdom of God. It is not a darbar with elevated thrones where the emperor would be sitting over there, very much surrounded by the intellectuals and all the ministers and so on. All the administrative chiefs are very much on. All the army would be in the front and the bevy of beauties would be at the back. No. The kingdom is something to do with the compassionate activities of the hand of God, heart of God, body of God, and the life of God. So the miracles, understand the miracles. It is not meant for underscoring the magical consciousness, but for historical commitment. Miracle stories are meant for deepening the historical commitments. These evils should be removed. What is my contribution? What is God's contribution for undoing the evils and the sinful tendencies of the world? The Holy Spirit has God, what you call sifting and removing the evil from the good, the convict and the to convict and the convert the sinners. You know, fall back to this. What is the purpose of the Holy Spirit? Removal of the evil and also to undo the mistakes. That is why Holy Spirit is calling a spade, convict the sinners, at the same time convert the sinners. And the Holy Spirit to continue to guide and direct the apostles. And that's why it was said as a spirit-triggered faith. The spirit-triggered charity. The spirit-triggered hope. It was triggered by the Holy Spirit. I would rather say, the Acts, who is the hero of the Acts of the Apostles? None other than the Holy Spirit. He or she, I do not know. But the Holy Spirit is the hero or heroine of the entire 28 books of the Holy Spirit. And the entire Bible is very much inspired by the Holy Spirit. And Acts 5, Acts 4, Acts 9, and so on. The Holy Spirit continues to guide and direct the apostles. Now, let's move into the purpose and the structure of the Acts of the Apostles. Luke does not delve into the complex social, economic, and theological forces that shaped early Christianity. My dear friends, the Acts of the Apostles is not a book on sociology, not a book of history, not a book of economic math, not a book of ideological clashes. Luke simply provides a smoothly flowing narrative that shows the birth and growth of the Christianity. It's a sort of small, little minority groups from the Judea, from the Palestinian world of the first century AD of the Christian era. And you know how slowly a particular faith energy it was spreading out, changing the entire life as such. But Luke's account is the only one we have of the earliest first century Christianity. There goes one particular problem in biblical studies. This is a faith document. How can I construct a society from this faith document? This is a faith document. How can I construct the economic side of the people? We don't have any statistics of the lifestyle of the people. There is no statistics or remarks with regard to the distribution of land. They talk about the distribution of properties, but there is no statistics on that. So mind you, this is not the textbook of history or textbook of local culture or textbook of socio-economic political activities. It is something to do with how this small little group was gradually growing. So he puts a spin on his account so as to downplay the theological controversies and present church leaders as a model of behavior. He is neither busy with the debates of ideologies, nor busy with the theological nuances, but how actually the visible movement of the church, became visibly growing. in spirit in order to encourage. So identify while going through what could have been the original intention of the author while going through that. You know, how we can identify the original intention of the author. For example, you come across a rhyme like this, twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. This is the text. What is the original intention of this particular text? And who should have been the original audience of this particular text? From the text, we try to understand the original intention or the purpose for which this particular literature or particular text was written, particular literary product was given, and so on. From the Acts, as we go through the entire Acts, page after page, chapter after chapter, pericope after pericope, we try to understand. And Acts is not history in the present. As we understand today, as I told you, present scholarly understanding of the term, there is a little in it about 11. There is nothing about all these apostles for which we need to have extra biblical resources, maybe from Josephus, maybe from other archives of the government. And we hear something about Peter. Peter is the leader of the early Christianity in Jerusalem. And we come across some people like John and James playing minor roles. And another James, not the original James, the elder brother, cousin brother of our Lord. Another James, he comes across in Galatians also. James also comes over there. Then slowly, Peter is receding. The spread of Christianity from Jerusalem to Rome to the ends of the earth is a key word in the first chapter. The progress is mainly geographical. Mind you, from Jerusalem to Samaria, Damascus, Antioch, Asia Minor, Europe, and finally Rome. How it is slowly spreading out. And it's a northern eastern corner of the Mediterranean world. And here we don't hear much about North Africa or Alexandria and Cyrene. They are mentioned, but you know, not quite often, it is very much confined. Remember, in those days, what we call international today is different from what they call international then. Try to understand that. The book Acts of the Apostles records for us the history of the Christianity's beginning and growth and spread during at least the first 30 years. From Christ's ascension in chapter 1 to Paul's imprisonment towards the end in Rome. He was originally imprisoned in Caesarea in Judea, then moved on to Jerusalem. Then from Jerusalem, he was, you know, shifted to Rome. For our curiosity, just locate Jerusalem, Dead Sea, Jordan River, Sea of Galilee, Israel Day. Damascus is just close by. Syria, Turkey, Antioch. Antioch, there are two Antiochs. You can see in the map itself. Okay, there are two Antioch in the map, in the New Testament map. Acts of the Apostles are mainly for the Greek-speaking audience because Greek was supposed to be the international language then. You know, Romans for speaking purposes would be busy with Latin, early Latin. Whereas for documentation, it is something like I might be speaking in Tamil with the common people, but perhaps for documentary purposes, for international contacts, I may make use of English, similarly French, or similarly Spanish. God kept his promise to Israel. You know, I was so surprised to see the long chapter of Stephen's martyrdom. The entire salvation history is enumerated. And Peter, with his first sermon after the Pentecost, the entire Israel's salvation history is very much kept over there. You know, for Israel's, for the mind of the Israel, the category of promise and fulfillment is a major category in their religious discourse. What God promised would be always completed. Remember, even the Gospel of Matthew, it could be even called the Gospel of Promise and Fulfillment. That's why Matthew is very keen in locating frequently in order to fulfill that particular law in from Torah. It has happened. This happened in tune with that particular promise. That particular orientation is a, it is their Jewish mindset. God kept his promise to Israel. Then God opens a new way, new marga, so to say. Early Christians, they didn't have even the title called Christians. First time they have been called Christians in Antioch. Till then, they were having, you know, that group, that followers of the Nazarene, a different type of people, all sorts of, you know, a new way, a new marga, the new way to non-Jews, Gentiles. God created the spirit-empowered Jewish community in Jerusalem. Jews are the first members of the church. Jews were the first members of the church. Jews remain the heirs of the prophet and within the covenant. Remember, it is a continuity from the Old Testament and certain change towards the New Testament. You know, this element has to be very much taken into consideration. For any living organism, there ought to be both the dimension of continuity as well as change. Continuity is something like a root. Change is something like a fruit. For any living organism, roots are there as well as the fruits are there. So with regard to the divine eruption caused by the birth of Jesus or the intervention of God through the person of Christ, you know, that particular element is in continuity with the prophets. That is why even while the disciples were moving towards Pentecost, moving towards the two disciples going with the risen Lord, they are not able to identify what is the name of the place?
Emmaus.
Emmaus.
Yeah, Emmaus. So Emmaus, on the way to Emmaus, they were just having a conversation and they are moving ahead. And these fellows are not able to identify him. And, you know, when he broke the bread, immediately their eyes were open. And Jesus admonished them, don't you know, it has to be done in continuity with the prophets, Torah and prophets. So remember, the continuity between the person of Christ and the new community. And the continuity between the Old Testament and the New Testament, the First Testament, the Second Testament, continuity on the one hand, rootedness on the one hand, as well as the spreading ramification of the tree on the other hand. So God opens up the new way. God's spirit, God's created the spirit-empowered Jewish community, and the Jews were the first members of the church, and Jews remain still the heirs of the prophets and within the covenant. Now, let's look into the outline, prologue on Jesus' ascension, founding of the Jerusalem church, work of Peter and the apostles, 3 to 5, and the persecution of the Hellenists, the Greek-speaking Jews, persecutions in the sense misunderstanding, distanciation, and also even in terms of indifference, callousness. That is why they had to choose another team. Now, you see the administrative structure, you know, you see, understand this particular issue of an outburst of charism. If at all want to serve people, you should have certain institutions. I'm not talking about institution in terms of buildings, certain structures, social structure, economic structure, and also even the political structure, how the power has to be operating. And that is why they come across with a new idea of deacons. So far, they have been apostles. Don't mix up apostles with the disciples. Disciples need not be apostles. Apostles could be disciples. Apostles, disciples, and the Christians, people. The persecution of the other language, other ethnic, other cultural groups, and preparation of the Gentile mission, slowly the reaching out of the early Christian church, and the first missionary journey of Barnabas and Paul, and the second missionary journey of Paul, and the third missionary journey of Paul in such chapters, you know. Then Paul's arrest in Jerusalem and imprisonment in Caesarea, and Paul's journey to Rome and his preaching to the Roman Jews over there. You know, prologue, the ascension of our Lord. It's a post-resurrection appearances. You know, Jesus in the Mount Tabor is transfigured. Mount Tabor is transfigured. Some say this was the foretaste of the resurrection, where there is a brilliance of face, and Moses, Elijah, and the prophets were prophets of the old. Moses to represent the Exodus event, and Elijah to represent the very movement of the prophetic outburst of the divine. And you know, Peter said, you know, Lord, how good it is, and so on. That is why the post-resurrection appearances in all the Gospels we come across with tremendous confusions. There was fear. There was helplessness. There was, you know, certain types of, you know, burying oneself alive like ostriches. They were something like the cockroaches very much hiding into the toilets. They were not able to see the broad daylight. They felt it's a time for their voluntary retirement, going back to their original profession. And it is there we come across the resurrection appearances. You know, resurrection appearance, if you compare all the resurrection appearances together, we might be more confused, because with too many confusions are there, both within the school of the apostles as well as the readers. Whereas with regard to the passionality, we have got a very something like a first information report in the police record. On 6 o'clock it happened, 9 o'clock it happened, 12 o'clock it happened. So post resurrection, which was surrounded by chaotic situation, they are out of gear. And it is here, within the 40 days, there was a visible ascension into heaven. Within the 40 days. 40 days back, he was a dead corpse. Right now, amidst all confusions and chaos, some enlightenment seems to be taking place, some bombardment. It is something like a high voltage wire penetrating to the thin hair-like thin wire. It gets blasted. The ordinary apostles were unable to handle that divine eruption, electrifying divine eruption. And here, Matthias is chosen to replace Judas Iscariot after the Pentecostal event. And Luke's understanding of the apostles, see 1:21 and 22. Let me read it. So, one of the men who have accompanied us, you see, underline the word accompanied us, during all the time that was the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, Jesus was moving in and out amidst us, accompanying the person of Jesus, flesh and blood, Mr. Jesus, and, you know, rubbing shoulders with, eating together, fighting together. And beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. Now, Paul did not live with Jesus. Is he an apostle or not? What is the qualification of being an apostle? The very word stellos means to be sent, to be ejected, to be catapulted, to be sent. Apostolos. Apostolos. In other words, an apostle is always in front of Jesus. To be. A disciple is always at the back of Jesus, following. That's why Pope Francis is talking about you need to be both in front of Jesus as well as at the back of Jesus. We are in the front of Jesus as well as the back of Jesus. So Matthias is chosen to replace Judas Iscariot, Luke's understanding an apostle over there. And Luke hardly ever refers to Paul as an apostle. But in the epistles, Paul refers to himself as the apostles. As the apostle himself. So how come the very title matters in the early? We talk about the apostolic authority. So we dwell on this particular point also for our discussion. And the founding of the Jerusalem Church, the role of the Holy Spirit. In Jerusalem Church, the Jerusalem Church increases in number by means of divine power. You can count many times the people, number of people increased. Number of people increased. Not by their propaganda strategies, but by means of divine power. The work of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, is a glossolalia. Glossolalia, this is the Greek word. Glossolalia. Well, see, behold, I will send my spirit upon the young ones, young men and the young women. And the young people would see the dreams. And the elder people would see the visions. That particular quotation would be there in chapter 2. Peter's speech interprets the meaning of the Pentecost. The first sermon over there, in the second chapter, the character of the Jerusalem church, how they were very much having a community with apostles as the epicenter, apostles as a counselor, the apostles as a main instruction, the apostles as the main teachers, and you know they were spreading, putting forth. Pretty control the admin, please. And you know they come together. Rajkumar, alert me when I need to give a break.
Yes, now I was just thinking of that.
Yeah.
Now we could have a few minutes break for questions.
Yeah, just one more minute. Just
the please go ahead.
The character of the Jerusalem church in terms of sharing the resources. Sharing the faith means sharing the resources. Sharing the communion means sharing what I have and what I am together. Remember, the life and mission is integrated. My life is the root. My mission is the fruit. So there was an internal integration and external integration. There is a vertical integration within the divine and the human, and the horizontal integration between the human and the human, and the human and the nature. So there was an attempt of, you know, the Holy Spirit making from fragmentation to integration. That's what we understand in the early church. You know, people were not prepared. It was given as a revelation. And again, the Holy Spirit is spreading the gospel. And people are coming and trying to cooperate with mixed types of response. Some people responded well. Some people didn't respond well. When they are not responding, somehow they fell apart from the community. Now it's a time for us to come with some discussions. We can spend some time with the discussion right now.
So, my dear friends, now over to you. You might be definitely having some clarifications, needing some clarifications or questions, etc. Please. Go ahead.
Hello, Father.
Yes, Prakash.
Yeah. Yeah, in Acts chapter 1, verse 21, as Father said, to be an apostle, it is necessary that one of the men who accompanied us in the whole time. So the Lord Jesus came and went among us. So I just wanted to know, what is the difference between apostle and disciple? Or what should be the criteria to be an apostle and to be a disciple?
Good. From the Gospels, we come across, you know, Jesus named them, participating in their daily life, with a physical presence. And he named them apostles and sent them two by two. The very word, stellos, means to be sent, to be sending ahead. That was the original meaning. Were they followers of Christ, or they originally, they were followers of Christ also? So they were from behind. Disciples, the word meaning of the disciple is following at the footsteps of Christ. Apostolos means you are with me, let me now propel yourself. And this was the original meaning, original understanding in the early church. But slowly, you know, apostles are in close proximity with Christ. Disciples are following the Spirit of Christ. This is the understanding. We talk about the apostolic church. One, Catholic, Holy, Apostolic Church. Now, what is meant by apostleship? My dear friends, my faith in Christ is not the product of my personal encounter with Christ. I need to personally encounter Christ, but the communitarian faith, faith through the church. You know, the fellows in close proximity, they cherished Christ and touched Christ, smelled Christ. They smelled Christ. And it is something like a direct encounter with Christ, which was eventually given over by tradition. I tell you, you know, mother is munching on chocolate. And the child is asking, Mama, I need a chocolate. Ayyo, this is the last piece. I given you already, no? Mama, I need one more chocolate. Immediately, the mother who is, you know, munching the chocolate, feeds the child through the tongue itself. This Christ experience was handed over to us from the very College of the Apostles. That's what is meant by apostolic faith. I don't claim a faith with my own merit. I am getting the udder's milk, mother's milk. Who is the mother? The College of the Apostles. So it is handed over from generation to generation. Say, apostolic means touching upon the very core of the heart of Jesus with a due authority, with a due charismatic authority, it is a hotline. It's a hotline, so to say. So that's what we mean by apostles. First of all, it was a close physical proximity with Jesus, and eventually it becomes a sort of an ongoing pipeline for giving us the energies from Jesus, divine eruption from Jesus. Obviously, Matthias was not living with Jesus, but eventually he had to be replaced. Suppose one pope dies, we are not crying the church is over. No. There ought to be certain continuity. That's why I change continuity and change. Not everyone who shouts Christ, 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 Christ is an apostle. Not everyone who talks about Christ, Christ is a disciple. Not everyone who talks about Christ, Christ, Christ is a Christian. What is the main line? Enough to be empowered by the power of Spirit of God. It turns out to be now part of the apostolic church, capable of becoming disciple of Christ and capable of becoming a credible Christian.
Thank you, Father. But just to clarify one more, this Matthias, he was chosen to replace Judas.
Yeah.
So he is an apostle or disciple?
Once there is a continuity, for example, when one pope dies, another pope is chosen. When another is chosen, he's an apostle or a disciple. He's a pope or a pseudo-pope or a semi-pope. He becomes authorized person to be an apostle. He becomes authorized. It's an authorized.
Yeah, thank you, Father. Thank you so much.
Okay.
For clarifying. Yeah.
Anyone else? Please go ahead. Unmute and ask. Father Raja, in the meanwhile, you could take some water.
Yeah.
Usually they post questions in the chat. This time I told them not to do it. So perhaps they have forgotten their own questions.
There's one question, Father, whether yes. Paul is an apostle or disciple. Philonis Mary wants to know okay. whether Paul is an apostle or disciple.
Okay. Father, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Yes. Paul calls himself as a servant of Jesus Christ. Please open up Romans 1:1. When he is sending the from address, someone could read that.
Take that Bible, please. Anyone has Bible?
Anyone ready with the NRSV?
Yes, I have, Father.
Okay.
Paul, a servant of Christ yes. Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart from the gospel of God.
Okay. When Paul claims to be an apostle, when the early Christians make this document as a canonically venerable document, did the community accept this Pauline apostleship or not? Luke doesn't refer to him as the first instance, him as an apostle. Early church, after the little bit of early period of turbulence of Pauline negative intervention in the church, murdering, killing all the people following the new way. And eventually he became an active participant in spreading the word, even to the extent of getting persecuted. Romans is written sometime around the 60s, sometimes around mid-50s and so on. When Paul himself is talking about himself an apostle, called to be an apostle of the Gentiles. Remember, there was a little confusion in terms of, labeling people. That's why we come across in this particular tension, everyone, am I not an apostle? Because I'm talking in tongues. Am I not an apostle? I'm performing the miracles. Am I not an apostle? There was a little bit of a each one claiming to be an apostle. But the community as such, it projected some people with an apostolic authority. What matters ultimately is, I know Christ. Is it because I lived with Christ? The question is, in so far as I am following the spirit of Christ, it's a community's job to give me a title. And Paul, after receiving the title from the community, makes use of this title, apostle. There is a difficulty to Paul. Suppose a persecutor, a dictator, a persecutor is becoming an archbishop within a dictator who persecuted the church is made an archbishop in a diocese, what would be the mindset of the people? The same crisis was, faced by Paul. That is why he had to explain himself. I'm not an alien to you. I am part of you. I am part of the close followers of Christ. Not only close followers of Christ, after my conversion, I was very much involved in the apostolic colleges for deepening the Christian faith, for spreading out the Christian faith. Early church did not have the difficulty in accepting Paul as an apostle. That is why it is brought into the canonical book. Otherwise, it would have been thrown out. You are a self-styled apostle, we dismiss you. They would have said it. Paul is an apostle as accepted by the early Christian communities.
Thank you, Father. There are other questions as well.
Yeah, we can just address them.
Rezi Rose, he has asked how Paul's claim to be apostle first letter he has to step back to be the least of the apostles? Was it the internal fraction dispute of authorities in early church?
Very much, very much, very much. Am I not an apostle? Paul asks. You know, physical proximity with Christ alone is not the criterion. I can, even Judas was physically very much dear to Jesus, no doubt. Is an apostle as an attributed status or an achieved status? Apostles, every call is not only freely given, but it has to be achieved. For example, I am a Jesuit. Have I become a full-fledged Jesuit? Till I die, I need to keep on growing as Jesuit, keep on becoming a Jesuit. Am I a full-fledged Christian? Till I die, I need to grow, keep on growing as a Christian. In other words, it is to be achieved also. It is to be accepted also. It has to be celebrated also. There was a little tussle, very true. Difference in terms of, you know, Peter was very much, you know, understand, try to understand these fellows. Peter as an illiterate man, an ordinary laborer, whose scope is rather minimally confined only to the Judean world. Even while coming to the national city of Jerusalem, is a dialect betrayed, is, you know, rural dialect. It's a rural behavior. They identified him. Hey, I saw you with that man. Your dialect too. Some little disturbance, please. Disturbance.
Please mute your microphones, others.
Yeah. So that is why, whereas Paul, with his sophisticated education, with the different types of reach out to many cities, and also with the long journeys and so on, his scope is rather large. So that is why, in this particular context, early conflicts were there. You know, this could be, conflicts could be in terms of personal conflict, person-to-person conflict, ideological conflicts, strategic conflicts. All the difficulties were there in the early church. We can look at a reading of conflicts in the Acts of the Apostles, plenty. So this is also possible. Whereas there was a necessity of Paul to project his credential, because he was rejected everywhere. Wherever he went, you know, the CID policemen would be just following him from the Jewish community, even from the church. Just check what the doctrine is all right, whether he's betraying us and so on. That is why Paul had the difficulty of explaining his vocation as a new person, all this. He had to prove his credentials.
Yes. Thank you, Father. There is one more question. Alvin, please go ahead. Ask your question. He's saying that something connected to Old Testament. I think Father Maria Ruraja would be able to clarify.
Yeah. Father, I would like to ask, there in the books, many books in the Old Testament, it was referred as other gods. See, when I'm reading the Bible, I only believe in one God. Then how can an author or the writer can write it as other gods when there is only one God? So I just want a clarity on that. There were pagans, there were called a God called Baal, or there were different kinds of gods were there. I want to know, what is other gods? I didn't understand that.
You know, when we talk about the divine experience or faith experience and make use of the language always links. Language also struggles. Remember, even in the Old Testament, even the First Testament, there was not a sudden understanding of the one God. It was slowly evolving in the history of the Israel people themselves. For example, start with Peter, start with Abraham. As an elderly fellow with no offspring, with elderly woman, with no possibility of any pregnancy and childbirth, and as a migrant, their first experience of God was house visiting God. It was not an understanding of universal God. It was a barren couple with no possibilities of future, and they were afraid of death and so on. And that is why, as a large measure, as an emergency measure, you know, Abraham was asked to beget a child with the help of the handmaid and so on and so forth. Even there, they are not confused whether three or one. Apparently, the visitors in the wilderness, it was a house visiting God. Then comes slowly after, you know, after Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, then they identified God as a God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, God of Joseph. Second, it's a sort of kinship God. God is a generic term. There are other cultures where people also worshipped with a different creed, with a different cult, with a different connotation. That's why when they, in the migration, when they encountered other people, they identified another creed, another code, another cult, which they hold as God. Divine experiences everywhere in every culture with a different style of evolution. You get into the sociology of religion, how religions have been evolved. Some gods were projected out of fear. Some gods were projected out of necessity. Some gods were projected out of, you know, my own power, the aspiration for my power, which I project as God. And second, but thirdly, then comes, it's a God of Israel. God of Israel. It's become an ethnic God. Though this question may not be related immediately for our context, ethnic God. Then comes another understanding of the God of the nations. God of, even in the Israel's mind, there was an evolution of the concept of God, not an immediate acceptance of, not an immediate revelation as a sort of God revealed, but for their understanding was growing. And only in the second Isaiah, after getting bombarded with plenty of colonial activities, and also even in terms of, you know, very many people coming and together as the slaves, they bombarded with other God. They are bombarded with other people and other gods. That's why, you know, different people have the freedom to label their gods as gods. That is why in English, we come across what you call monotheistic God with a capital G and other gods as a small g. Some sort of an attempt at the level of expression, linguistic expression. Because the revelation of God, let's not claim, I understood the monotheistic God. I understand fully. It is always growing. It's always growing. The concept of God that I have when I was 5 years old is not as same as the concept of God that I have right now as a senior fellow. No, it grows. That does not mean they accepted the other gods. By way of expressing in terms of other gods, and does not mean, you know, they accepted the God, other gods. It's a question of linguistic struggle and human inability to articulate. At the same time, there is a growth process in person as well as in a community.
Thank you, Father. There is someone, I see the hand, Celine, or someone want to ask, but I hope that we can keep that for the end. Now we can continue with the second session because you will have the second segment. Go ahead with that. Around 6:40, we can stop and then go for the last few minutes of questions. So Celine could keep your question and ask after 6:40.
Yeah, we can just listen to the question alone right
now. Okay, Celine, please go ahead. I just saw hands raised.
And one more question I saw.
Okay.
One more question.
Can I ask one question?
Yes, please go ahead, Sylvia. Yeah, please.
Father, my question was, normally it is maintained that Luke Acts is a work that has been written after 70 AD because he has knowledge of the destruction of the Jerusalem temple, right? Then how is it, Father, that Acts, you know, suddenly that abrupt ending of Acts after chapter 28 does not tell us what happened to Paul after he arrived in Rome? It only mentions that he lived there for another 2 whole years and did a lot of teaching. But we know that Paul died somewhere around 67 AD before Nero died. So how is it that Luke does not mention anything about Paul's death and what happened to him after he arrived in Rome?
Suppose Luke was dead before Paul.
Probably that's what I was thinking. But then, yeah. Father, how is it then the work was written after 70 AD we maintain?
Yes, that's why some say from 60 to 80. Even if it is written after 70, there is no need of mentioning Paul's death also. Perhaps the news of Paul's persecution might not have arrived Luke. We can construct, but we do not have the final answer. The one thesis is Luke would have died, or Luke did not have the information, or he wanted to have the question of persecution story reaching up to the headquarters of Rome. That is sufficient. Once you reach the headquarters of Rome was something like international head then. And he wanted to project that it is a good news to be spread only in the context of persecution. With that end, he might have even concluded. The same thing, difficulty we come across in the Gospel of Mark. Such an unhappy ending of Mark chapter 16:8. But finally, afterwards, you know, people added a little more, and certain additional elements of 9 to 20 occurs over there in Mark Gospel. And Patrick Lewis says, I say, without Paul, Christianity might not have taken hold and grown into church that would change the world. I thank Paul. If not for Paul, all the Christians would be circumcised today.
Definitely.
And even to the extent of C.H. Dodd says, Paul is the second founder of Christianity. Correct. By the way, don't take Paul so in a romantic fashion. Paul is also the most hated and the most embraced apostle. Wherever he went, there were opposition. And wherever he went, he spread out the gospel effectively. Something like Pope Francis, no? He's the most loved pope and the most critiqued pope as well. I hope you remember all these things. Paul was just like Pope Francis. Wherever he went, there was stiff opposition, and also there was stiff. Paul was a darling of Gentiles, and especially in the early church, he was the voice of the Gentile. He made Gentiles on a par with. There was a Jewish pride of having the covenant, and Paul said, "Shut up! Salvation through Christ is not based on circumcision." In other words, that is why you remember, Paul is creating an atmosphere of transcending the confines of Torah. Even today, the Jewish people are not able to see eye to eye because somehow even their very label, as soon as you talk about the Old Testament, they say, shut up. What is old? Old is not to be dismissed. That's why these days we call First Testament and Second Testament. Get into the emotional side also. Paul was very instrumental. I appreciate Paul for his networking, powerful networking, with generating energies and keeping on building the community ceaselessly with the constant communication. Enter into the ideologies, enter into the strategies, mission strategies, and also with the personal touch. Great of Paul. Yes, Father Rajkumar, we can proceed.
Yes, Father, please go ahead with the second segment. Yes.
The work of Peter and other apostles. You know, 3, 4, 5. Confrontation between the apostles and the Jerusalem authorities. You know, the Jerusalem authorities, these are the illiterate people and they don't know how to handle them. And Luke's attitude towards the Sadducees and Pharisees. Sadducees and Pharisees, again, especially Sadducees to the high priest, they gathered together. They were instrumental in bringing the authority, bringing the apostles to the court and flogging them. You read the text to yourself. Now there comes the Stephen, the leading Hellenist. When you talk about the Hellenism, which is a Greek-speaking Jew. Mind you, Greek-speaking Jew. Now we come across people who may not be at home with their own mother tongue, but they are fluent in some other language. For example, a Sri Lankan living in Canada might be good at English, may not be at home with the mother's language. A Greek-speaking Jew presented as the first Christian martyr. You just ask for yourself, why on this 26th itself, the 26th December, Stephen's martyrdom is placed immediately the next day after the birth of Christ. Can't he change the date? On 25th, we are in jubilation. On 26th of December, we are very much on the in terms of Stephen's martyrdom. Why? Let us ask. Subsequent persecution and growth of the church, again, it was as the word is spreading, people are also persecuted. The new marga, new way carried to such individuals as Simon the magician. He was, you know, read the story, it's a pleasant story. He was a magician, he's a Mr. Populo, and he was working great things. But eventually, while he came over here, seeing Peter laying hands and the new things emerging, he wanted to buy the power of the Spirit. He wanted to monetization. Monetization takes place. And, you know, Simon saw the point and he was able to understand. He was open to the Spirit. Ethiopian eunuch. Ethiopian. You see all sorts of people with the different statuses of life. The role of Philip in the work of evangelization, especially in Samaria. You know, there was a tension between the Jews and Samaritans. They're part of the Jewish. Audio effect, please. Some disturbance. Admin. Admin, please look into the audio effect.
Everyone is muted, Father, and I don't hear any disturbance. I'm not sure about the others. Is it clear, Father? Father, you're on mute.
Father Raja, you have to unmute yourself. And we hear, so far we were hearing well. All the others, please keep your microphones off. Mute only Father Raja. Please go ahead, Father.
Yeah. The conversion of Saul of Tarsus. Please always parallelly read the conversion of Paul in three chapters. You can note it down, chapter 9, chapter 22, chapter 26. On different occasions, Paul's conversion story is told and retold. Told and retold.
Hello?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, okay. In chapter 9, Luke is talking about the conversion of Paul. In chapter 22, in front of the soldier, the captain of 1,000 soldiers, Paul is talking about his stories and he's explaining to them in Jerusalem. And in 26, in front of Agrippa, Herod Agrippa, with his wife in the court, Paul is talking about his own conversion. You parallelly go through these three stories together. And you can come across the differences with audio effect and video effect, with the appearance of light, appearance of Christ, or the voice from heaven, or how others, whether Paul's companions who were journeying from Jerusalem to Damascus were hearing or not, or he alone saw that. There are variations. And Luke is very smart in placing the stories at the right moment, when to repeat the story, when not to repeat the story, and so on. You can appreciate the literary devices with which he has constructed this particular story. Peter is depicted as the one who first opens the doors to the Gentiles, the non-Jews, the Peter's persuasion of the circumcision party. You remember, just like today, there are extremists in those days also, whom they call circumcision party. It's a derogatory remark, circumcision party. and also look into the Gentile aspects in terms of chapter 10 and 11. Especially, I please look into the Pentecostal text, chapter 1. You read, what are the people, what are the nations, what are the various types of linguistic groups that were present. Please take up Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles. Chapter 2, Coming of the Holy Spirit. Coming of the Holy Spirit. From 5 onwards. Someone read now. Chapter 2, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2.
Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power."
Okay. Now, I like to underscore 2:1. Pentecost came. 2:5. Devout Jews from every nation. You see, the name Jews is mentioned. Now, sound management, please. Jews from every nation. You see the word every nation, it means every people. Ethnos means people, every people. And speaking in their native language, who are the listeners? Foreigners. They are speaking in their language, foreigners. And are they not Galileans? Chapter 7, verse 7. You see, another language is spoken. And my native language is the medium of understanding. It's a funny type of an event. It's a funny type of an event. And see the ethnic identities mentioned in the large list. Some sound management, please.
Hello.
Okay. Now it's okay.
It's all of you.
Yeah, good. Now, on the one hand, they are mentioning the people, and on the other hand, they talk about the geographical location, sometimes the ethnic location, sometimes the linguistic identity, sometimes even national identity, even continent they talk about, Asia. This is how even in the early church, it was internationalized. It was democratized, irrespective of the borderlines of creed, code, cult, nation, and so on and so forth. That is why, on the one hand, there is an extreme possibilities of universal reach out. On the other hand, there was a certain obsession in terms of circumcision, certain localized type of an ideology. This is how religion becomes an ideology. True. At one moment, God insisted on circumcision, but focusing only on circumcision is fundamentalism. That is why in Galileans, we come across those Judaizers, those who are the fundamentalists of the Jewish religion. What is the understanding of fundamentalism? You know, fundamentalists are good people, but They get bogged down only with one particular aspect of the truth. They are also truthful. But instead of looking at the entire fabric of the truth, multiple aspects of the truth, they get bogged down with only one aspect of truth at the cost of the other. That is why there is always an exaggerated claims of the fundamentalist groups. In the early stages, this is a major struggle. It's a major struggle. The preparation for the Gentile mission, Gentiles flock to the church. When you talk about the church, I'm not talking about the church in the building, people of God. The church flocked to the church as Antioch. And Jerusalem church sends Barnabas to report on the situations. Barnabas and Paul at Antioch, and gospel preached all over Judea and Samaria. And eventually you come across from Samaria to the entire world. The first half concludes with an account of Herod Agrippa's persecution of the Jerusalem community. God is unhappy with the Herod, that particular Herod. Remember, there are more than six Herods. The one who died at the early stage of 27 BC before Christ's birth, and one who was Herod who is, you know, during Jesus' birth, and another Herod, you know, who was invited, who planned for inviting Jesus for doing the magic in his darbar. And, you know, this Herod is another guy. You know, Herod is a common name. You can see the map afterwards. The first missionary journey of Barnabas and Paul, you know, let me go ahead. Let me have dissension, last but one. Dissension between the Gentile and the Jewish Christians or adherence to the Mosaic law, Torah. This is the first conflict story in the Acts of the Apostles. It was a major conflict, and Paul was present here representing the interests of the, you are forcing us to circumcise or not. No, God is beyond circumcision. Democracy is a gospel. Don't put as a necessary condition. Always, you know, they put the with a star in their footnote, conditions apply. You become Christian, conditions apply. No, don't have any condition. Unconditional law cannot be controlled by the Jewish tradition of. That is why they come out with the new possibilities of ethics. The evolution, this is how we like to see the relationship between the religion and ethics. Must Gentile Christians be circumcised and observe the Jewish dietary laws? Especially in India today, we talk about, you know, people are imposing their dietary practices, a minority group imposing the dietary practices upon others, what to eat and what not to eat. And, you know, it's a typical Pharisaic mind, Brahminic mind, and so on. This is how early church, I venerate Paul on this particular ground. Don't control God. Don't control God with your traditions, with your darling traditions. In this first Jerusalem conference was sometime around 49. Must a Gentile believer become a Jew to become a Christian? This was the agenda of the division. The dispute was settled in favor of the uncircumcised Gentiles. Thanks to Paul and thanks to the openness of Peter, and they are really the pillars of the church. The deciding voice is that of James, the person who later succeeded Peter as the head of Jerusalem church. There are for and against. There was a collective spiritual conversation and a communitarian discernment over there. James requires only limited Torah mandates of the Gentile Christians. No, but you know, Torah is very significant, no? Requirements based on the rule from Leviticus. Please read Leviticus and also the text of Manu Dharma. Always read Deuteronomy along with the text of Manu Dharma. Read such a purity pollution code. And let me go to it is themes of unity and cooperation dominate throughout with all dissent, with all, you know, dissenting voices. It is a unanimous decision that the whole church sends a delegation to Antioch. Next to Jerusalem, Antioch is gaining significance. And it is there we come across, they have been called the Christians for the first time. The one who is after Christ, with Christ, and into Christ is a Christian. Actually, a decision of the Holy Spirit over there in the 15th chapter. And Paul's independence of the apostolic church. on the one hand, what do you mean by this? Paul was not mandated by the apostolic church in the sense it was not Peter or James or some other apostles who just authorized Paul to be an apostle. It was Christ who made him an apostle. So that's what I mean by independence of the apostolic church. He's not away from the apostolic church. Paul, for his getting the spiritual energies, did not have this particular aspect of as a secondary. Paul was not made a broker from the apostolic church. Paul is also having the same link with the Jesus energy. Luke and Paul differ on later, differ on some issues. And let me go to the next slide. Second missionary journey. Paul and Barnabas separate. Why this separation? Paul and Silas visit church in Syria and Asia Minor. A vision directs Paul to Macedonia. I'm interested in locating, why there was a sort of, was Paul such a strong person that no one could work together peacefully for long years? For long years. No, when people live together, there are difficulties. Quite often they say many of the religious founders, you cannot live with them. Such a charismatic fellows with so much of zeal. They are go-getters quite often. The other fellows, sometimes may not be. That's why I like to locate in every living together, in every communitarian aspects of working together, we need to have, are we sharing the same faith? If not with the same intensity, are we having the sharing the same faith? When the faith is made into an ideology for working together, are we having the same vision and mission and the ideological unison? Then strategies, are we sharing the same vibrations with regard to the strategies of our mission? Are we sharing the same type of program? Programs may be different from one person to another, but we need to have certain minimum, common minimum works and so on. Our vision directs Paul to Macedonia, and quite often intuition plays an important role, which they call the inspiration by the Spirit. Paul's customary activity related to the Jews and being abused by them. Everywhere Paul is challenged by Jews. The second remission, Paul in Philippi, Thessalonica, Beroea. Paul speaks at Areopagus, another in Athens, and Paul is in Corinth. Paul in Ephesus, third missionary journey. Luke depicts Paul as determined to complete his last tour and Imperial Rome over there, 19. Paul's farewell speech as Miletus. And the third journey, Paul returns to Jerusalem, back and forth from Jerusalem to Jerusalem, then arrested. And he is arrested. I'm a Pharisee, he says. Pharisee is a good shepherd. But what is wrong with the Pharisees is obsession. But he became an obsessed Pharisee, becoming an open Christian. His identity, yes, I'm a Jew, but I'm an open-ended Jew. Paul is imprisoned and he exercises his birthright as a Roman citizen. He defends himself. Then Paul's sea journey to Rome. There was a tempest and a shipwreck in Malta. And they're narrating the first person plural, that is we. And Acts ends with Paul's arrival in Rome. And Paul's journey, I can just skip this. The book's purpose is historical motive. It is not a history text, but it has a historical agenda. History of the continuation of Jesus' work by the Holy Spirit through the apostles. And the final instruction, come on, continue the work. Don't be riveting your attention upon the heavens. Oh, Galileans, Galileans. Why are you looking at the heavens? Go back. It is something like, when in John's Gospel, when Mary of Magdala is falling at the feet of the risen Lord, Rabuni, and crying, Jesus, like the mother hen, pecking its own kids, pecking its own chicken. Don't get bogged down. Go to Galilee. Go to other places. Go to my brothers. Don't get bogged down over there. Go to periphery. the same thing is there. Acts of the Apostles is driving us to the peripheries, to the ends of the world. Another is a defensive motive. In the early church, you know, it's quite often there was a much more conflicts from within, conflicts from outside, conflicts from government officials. They have been arrested multiple times and they've been persecuted. Sometimes some of the apostles, sometimes along with the apostles, the entire group would be having the persecution. Sometimes conflicts, personal conflicts, as well as communitarian conflicts, ethnic conflicts, and sometimes challenges from other religions also. Challenges from other religions also. See, Acts 13, there was a meeting with Sergius Paulus. Acts 16, officials at Philippi. Acts 19, officials at Ephesus. Acts 24 and 26, officials from top officials from top officials of Felix, Festus, Agrippa. There have been certain negativities, negative vibrations from the top up and also bottom up also. And also everywhere there was a difficulty, and the Acts of the Apostles is steering through all these difficulties. Biographical motive, mainly Peter's initial works and Paul's main works. Peter, to a great extent, is Jewish but open to the Gentiles, and Paul, definitely open to the Gentiles. The book Acts of the Apostles records for us the history of the Christianity's beginning during the first 30 years, as I told you early, from Christ's ascension to Paul's imprisonment in Rome. The apostolic office and work. Now it's a time for us to evolve a structure. Every charism has to be streamlined towards an appropriate structure. You can read the Acts of the Apostles with regard to the tension between the charism and the institution. You know, Christianity was fossilized in the 4th century. You can see the congregations getting fossilized at some moment or other. Then prophetic elements come. They get animated and activated. The apostolic office in operation, doing the works of Jesus, selected and training the apostles to do so. Okay, that was Jesus' style of functioning. Jesus was not an excellent fellow as an individual performer. No, right from the beginning, he was busy with networking and collaboration. And as witnesses of Christ and witnesses of Christ to bear testimony to the entire world, it has to be a communitarian affair. That is why there was a struggle. You know, a community is a torture, we know. It's easy for us to perform the works alone, but a community, how to organize a community, how to enable the community animated with a particular focus, sharpening the vision and mission and the strategies and programs and so on. The apostolic office, a competent witness must give clear and accurate testimony. First of all, the genuineness of the any apostolic community is, you know, to be guided by the Spirit as the ambassadors of Christ, to sit upon the thrones with authority to rule over the church, not in the sense of ruling over, but, you know, power with. As soon as we talk about an authority, we need not put it negatively. We need to talk about the charismatic authority. We need to talk about the legal authority. We need to have the legal, the educational authority. We need to have the traditional authority. But each authority is capable of becoming a negative side of an authority. So apostolic authority means not to rule over, but to rule with. And it has to be always with a communitarian discernment. The preaching of the gospel, given by the varieties of expressions, the message preached in the different circumstances under which it was, different circumstances. And yet it continued steadfastly. That's why I told you, actually, the apostles is an ideal example for an integration between the continuity and change, roots and fruits, tradition and creativity. It is something like a dynamic consolidation. On the one hand, it gets consolidated. The tradition is consolidated with the historicity. And it is also growing in a dynamic way, open-ended, to new people with new idioms, with new discoveries. They spoke the word of God, they preached the word of God, the word of the Lord. How many times it occurs over there, you can appreciate. The preaching of the gospel, and decreased to keep that were ordained by the apostles and the elders which were at Jerusalem. Always any community should have certain do's and don'ts. For do's and don'ts, we need to evolve certain, you know, it is becoming slowly a structure. It is slowly a structure with all its stipulations or regularities and, you know, certain disciplined actions. For example, this particular young woman with her husband were hiding and they were keeping the income for themselves. There was a black money in their house. So Peter identified, no, this is not our way of proceeding. This is not our way of proceeding. Come on, this is not the way. So this particular literature encourages what you call communitarianism rather than capitalism. They're preaching the gospel, the way of salvation more accurately. State the fact. Reason with them from the scriptures, always with a tradition, tradition of scripture. Shrank not from declaring anything that was profitable. They did not become stingy in democratizing the gospel. It's a gospel of the grace of God. And story of conversion, number of conversions are related here. All have several things in common. In each case, the gospel was preached. None occurred separately apart from the preaching of the word, not by any miraculous event. You know, miracles were not for miracles' sake. Miracles for serving the word of God, humanizing the sinful world, and saved by grace because they believe the truth. This is a crucial point. Miracles for not as a show of power, but it's a manifestation of the divine hand. Are you able to believe the hand of God? And it is finally, it is meant for the obedience. Obedience to the Spirit. Should we obey you or should we obey God? Was a crucial issue when Peter and John were very much, you know, arrested and flogged. In the case of conversion, you see, Jews were converted and the conversion, believing, repenting and confessing and baptism. You see, finally, the membership increases in and through the baptism. Please understand the question of baptism here in the Acts of the Apostles. What was originally the original intention of the apostles, the baptism of John the Baptist? It is for conversion from sins. By the time Paul comes, and especially in terms of Romans, by 55, you know, Paul is beautifully synthesizing. Baptism is nothing but immersion into the body of Christ. You become co-human, co-divine with Christ. You are buried into the body of Christ. And when Christ is crucified, you are co-crucified. When Jesus is buried, you become co-buried. When Jesus arises, you become co-risen. That is why Paul is busy with the ento Christo. Ento Christo. It is something like being buried into Christ. Part and parcel of the cell of Christ. So when we talk about the conversion, all these elements we need to believe, repent, confess, and finally baptism. With regard to Jews, with regard to Samaritans, with regard to Eunuch, with regard to Saul, with regard to Cornelius, Lydia, Jailer, and Corinthians. And what it was, of whom it consisted, church. Yes.
Father, could you please wind up slowly because it's beyond time for especially Malaysia group, it is too late.
Okay. What is a church? What is its mission? What is its work? What is its worship? What is its growth? What is its development? We are the church and God is the final authority. And our job is to keep on building the communities amidst fragmentation. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
Thanks to the Holy Spirit and thanks to the Holy Spirit which inspired you. Who, she or he inspired you. Thank you so much, Father. That was good. Thanks for the PowerPoint as well. And quickly, I think Sheldon, you wanted to ask some question. I see already your hands up.
Yes, Father.
Please go ahead quickly.
Yeah, so I had a question. So there were some, like the Acts of the Apostles notes that there were some visions given to Paul. Later, there were some visions given to Peter. So the Acts presses on the importance of visions. So what is the importance of such visions today in the church? Can we say that today the visions are of importance only for the person to whom it is given? Like you earlier, know, the visions were given a lot of importance. Good. So what is the importance of visions today?
You know, remember, these are written either by meeting the person's concern or without meeting the person's concern. Let me go back to, you know, birth of Christ. You know, the story of birth of Christ by Matthew, it takes up the medium of dream to Joseph. Whereas the same type of, you know, Jesus' birth-related story is developing in Gospel of Luke when talking about Mary, it is mainly from apparitions. God's ways are myriad forms, different ways, creative ways. It cannot be controlled by only a singular way. It could be by vision also, it could be by dream also, it could be by enlightenment also, it could be by hearing also, it could be by, without any visible sign, God is capable of speaking out. And visions are possible, but I like to have one criterion. Any claim of vision, unless it promotes charity, it is not a divine vision. When a divine vision proclaims that I am the authority over the church, as from the many preachers, God appeared to me last night, Mother Mary appeared to me last night, here I am, listen to what I say, then one has to identify what are the effects of this vision. What are the ripples of this vision? Is it for building a community or dividing the community or accumulating authority or democratizing authority? It has to be seen from the fruits it bears. Thank you.
Thank you, Father. Thank you. Anybody else?
Father, I have one question, very fundamental question. Father, thank you for this nice session. 1 Timothy says, you know, all scripture is God-breathed. So what is scripture? Is it, I mean, at the beginning of, you know, during the time of Acts, there was no New Testament. So the First Testament, which part of it is, you know, when we say God's word, which part of it is God's word? Is every word in the Bible, you know, inspired by the Holy Spirit? So nothing to be, you know, discounted. Can you please give us some clarity?
Yeah. Please read in the Second Vatican Council this particular document on divine revelation. Catholic Church has got a beautiful compilation of the theology of inspiration. Let me fall back to the theology of inspiration of Quran. Nothing to be spilled over. Everything is controlled by God. When Prophet Muhammad was in a trance, Angel Jibril, they call it Jibril, Gabriel was a supervisor of the exam. He was, you know, unconscious. His hand was so active, he was keeping on writing, and nothing to be changed. There are extremists in terms of saying that Quran, nothing, not an iota to be changed. Other people are saying, you know, you just let it be a sort of hermeneutical rereading according to the needs of the people and so on. There is one theology of inspiration. With regard to Bible, you know, Jesus is the revelation. And the outburst of the Jesus' experience, the impact created in the people, eventually the people keep on dying. The memory was slowly fading away. Then they started writing. The community felt, this is a time for us to locate, to keep up the memories of Jesus' eruption, divine eruption through Jesus alive. And this is how the community was slowly opening up. God is also slowly cooperating. So human authors, Second Vatican Council says, God's word in human words. God is a universal love and human language has limitations. God's word in human word, when they are combined together, it is an inspired word, but exposed through the limited human languages. Hence, we need to have certain appropriate reading. As the Bible is inspired, you need to have an appropriate inspiration to read it. So that is where it is not a simple type of a magical type of inspiration, but a rational type of inspiration, historical type of inspiration. Ultimately, if at all the Bible reading, my Bible reading is going to build a community, it is an inspired reading of the inspired Bible. If it is going to fragment the community, it is a perspiration of the inspired text.
Thank you, Father.
Excellent. Dear Father Maria Ruraja, thank you so much for that lively, you involve yourself in the teaching. That's so wonderful. It affects people. And also you prepared a nice PowerPoint presentation. You gave us a good introduction to the book of the Acts, and then you explained the chapters. Finally, you brought a good summary of it. Excellent. Thank you so much. And it was beautiful to have you this evening with us and inspiring our friends, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much, everyone. Let's give him a clap. And next session is going to be on October 3rd. Next one, October 3rd. And then after that, 2 weeks after that, which means 3rd and then 17th, we will have. And then October 31st again. So next month, you will have three, because this month ends so early. So you will have 3 weeks with a week gap in between 3rd, 19th, 17th and 31st October. I will be sending reminders every time. You will get it. 3-4 days before the session, you always get it. Thank you so much, everyone. Wish you a good evening. God bless. Enjoy this act of the apostles.
Thank you, Father.
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 Thank you,
Father.
Thank you,
Father. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you,
Father.
Thank you so much, everyone. And I must, Charmin, I see guitar behind you. I think next session, October 3rd, can be your prayer song.
Sure, Father. Sure.
Excellent.
Sure.
Excellent. Thank you. And anyone else for the following week, after that 17th October, anybody wants to do the prayer song? Think about it. Send me a mail. So October 3rd, we have Charmin. Wonderful. God bless.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, everyone. And also thanks to Mrs. Maria Kavita for right from the beginning admitting, coordinating. Thank you. And Mr. Yesuratnam is always there. Wonderful.
Thank you, Father. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. David Anthony Swami, bye-bye. Sister Jinsi, bye.
Bye, Father. Thank you.
Bye.
Father Arul, do you have a couple of minutes? I do have a question, but I didn't want to hold the others up.
Very good. Go ahead. If Father is willing.
Father, yeah. You have time, Father
yeah.
Arul?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I want to first thank you for the explanation. One is on baptism and the defensive motive. That is very useful. It's connected to the question I'm going to ask you also. So we know that these days the word apostle is used, in corporates as well as among the gurus, the Hindu gurus who have apostles who are ambassadors. So my question is, when we talk to them, how do I authenticate my apostleship? I am scared to use the Great Commission of Jesus. I'd rather use the script verse from the Ascension where Jesus says, "You will be my witnesses." I'd rather use that. But today you explained the baptism in a little slightly different manner, which I can use while talking to them. But I want to get your wisdom. How do I defend my faith in terms of my apostleship or our apostleship, our call to apostleship, when we talk to them?
Good. Gospel always addresses the context, historical context. Gospel is not a universally hanging, impersonal energy as if, I need to just milk out from there. It's a living word. If it is a living word which addresses, if I'm suffering from typhoid, it addresses me through the medium of typhoid. It serves as an antibiotics to me towards typhoid. If the world is surrounded by corona, the word of God addresses the corona. In other words, God became flesh in order to dwelling amongst us, so that there is always a movement from brokenness to fullness. That is why the Nazareth Manifesto, oh, blindness, you lose the brilliance, and the lameness, you become Olympic champions. You are excluded, totally marginalized, and with all sorts of patriarchal caste or racist type of exclusion. Now they learn to be, they learn to become center. The movement from baby step of the movement from brokenness to fullness, even with or without articulation, that is the criterion of living out the gospel. What matters is not the title, because the title apostle would be misused by others. Apostle of GST, the apostle of the apostles of the CEOs of the multinationals. Let them apostle of violence, non-violence, and so on.
Right.
Besides all these things, the final criterion is, you know, the Matthew chapter 25. Someone is thirsty. What have you done?
Awesome.
Good Samaritan. An unnamed fellow is on the road as a dead corpse. What are you doing? What are you performing? In other words, the word becoming performance, faith that does justice, faith that promotes compassion, faith that, you know, moves forward an inch forward from brokenness to fullness.
Beautiful. Thank you, Father. That's very, very helpful.
So you are in Vijay depth.
Yes, Father. I'm a student. Yes.
I have shared our credentials so that she could also coordinate in case my internet goes off or I'm not able to, she would be there.
This is how Paul was networking with others.
Suresh Ratnam is also one of our coordinators, and then Sheldon. So three people are with us.
So you are a legion.
Bangalore, Suresh Ratnam from Chennai, Sheldon from Bombay, Mumbai.
So you are not an atomistic person, but you are a legion.
Thank you, Father Raja. Very interesting. Thank you. So we'll close here.
Okay.
Thank you, Father.
Okay. Bye, Father. Bye.
Thank you so much, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Good night.
Bye, Father. Bye.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you. Stop recording. Where do I stop recording? Yes.